Good afternoon and welcome to this unique learning opportunity created for SCF donors, fund holders, and our community's professional advisors. We encourage you to continue enjoying your lunch as we get started. Each year, the Spartanburg County Foundation hosts several educational opportunities for our donors and our fund holders, our community, nonprofit organizations, and the public. Thank you for joining us today for our first 2024 educational session. Today, we will hear more about the partnership between Abundance Capital and the Foundation that was first announced in November of last year. The Foundation's trustees are excited about this partnership that will expand our collective effort to improve the lives of Spartanburg County residents. Today, we will hear from Mike Gatchell, who will review how the partnership works. He will then introduce representatives leading two local projects that Mike and his team believed are positioned to create local impact. Upstate Warrior Solution leads one project to build economic mobility for local veterans. The other project is Aiden Bonded Warehouses, an economic development initiative in Spartanburg's Northside community. Mike Gatchell is co-founder and chief executive officer of Abundance Capital. Mike brings his extensive professional experience in business, higher education, nonprofits, and community development to his work at Abundance Capital. Abundance Capital is a nonprofit venture philanthropy platform that helps charitable donors make impact investments in their communities, generating inclusive prosperity and creating sustainable local economies. Please give Mike a warm welcome.
Thank you to Troy, Karen, the whole team here at Spartanburg County Foundation. You all always do a terrific job. The space is wonderful, and it's just, we're excited about this partnership. It's a really neat opportunity to, I think, for a community foundation like this, especially one with a legacy of Spartanburg County Foundation, to extend its offerings and do some new and creative and innovative things. And we're just glad to be a part of it. I'll give you a little refresher on what we do, and I'll connect the dots a little about how the partnership works, as we have two groups here today that will specifically address initiatives and things that they're doing that are really perfect fits for this thing we call venture philanthropy. And so they'll be able to unveil and talk a little bit about those projects. Let me make sure that you all have met Margaret Gifford. Margaret, raise your hand. Margaret is our chief investment officer, also co-founder. Margaret and I, we launched this 2 years ago. Venture philanthropy is a new way to give. So we're at 501c3. We are a public charity. Call ourselves a venture philanthropy intermediary, which means really it's just a fancy way of saying we help charitable donors use their tax-deductible giving to make impact investments in the causes and the communities they care about. A different way to put their philanthropy to work. There are two ways we fashion the work of Abundance. So one is in the header of this slide and one is in the header of the next slide. One of the thesis point of Abundance Capital was, could we find a way to make philanthropy more impactful with local economic development? This is a great way for people who would like to invest in entrepreneurs and opportunities in their community, but maybe those opportunities don't fit their normal investment philosophies or their investment plans. But this is great risk capital. This is a great way to use your tax-deductible charitable dollars to be able to put into entrepreneurs and to things that will actually build a local economy. So we can do all sorts of investments. We make loans, we make equity placements, we do combinations of both of those, lots of revenue share. There's lots of different creative ways we've invested in profit, for-profit and nonprofits, which is really cool that we have both represented here today. Companies, real estate projects, impact funds, you name it. We've done a little bit of everything. We've made about almost 20 placements now, and we've done a little bit of everything so far. But what we're really doing is helping to open up capital access for entrepreneurs that perhaps aren't right fit for other sources of capital that are out there. For whatever reason, the other sources just aren't a good fit, whether it's traditional bank loans, traditional venture funds, or private equity. I often describe it in this way. And you know, when entrepreneurs will start a business, usually their first source of income, their first source of capital would be that whole, it's called sort of friends and family category. You get help from those closest to you. Well, there's a lot of people that just don't have the right friends and family to be able to put the money into their business. So donors can surround them and invest them in that way. But we also describe our work as being highly open sourced. One of the greatest ways we find opportunities is donors themselves bring lots of ideas and opportunities to us and things they would like to make investments or loans to. They collaborate with other donors. So a donor will have an idea and we'll share the idea across the rest of our fund holders, which we call angels, and donors go in together. And we're also doing some work to have some funds that are pooled funds where multiple donors can put their money in a particular fund in an organization like Upstate Warrior. Lots of different ways that we're beginning to find opportunities for donors to plug in. We geek out sometimes about the sort of the coolness of the platform and that we can do this. We can take charitable capital. We can make all these investments. And it's cool to talk about. This is all about people. This is all about relationships. So for us, we get more joy and fulfillment when we're connecting with entrepreneurs and connecting with donors, connecting donors with entrepreneurs, just like traditional philanthropy. This is still philanthropy. It's just the flavor of philanthropy. So last thing I want to do is just describe to you the 1-2-3 here. How does the partnership work? A foundation fund holder, if they wanted to participate in this venture philanthropy, would open a companion donor advised fund with abundance. We call it an angel fund. So we're structured as a donor advised fund. We're not out there trying to do the same things that a community foundation is trying to do, but you have the ability to open a donor advised fund with us. And we sort of call it a companion fund to the one that you might have here. So you can grant funds from that fund you have here over into the fund with us, or you could make a direct contribution if it was easier. And that part in the middle is the fund, right? So then you've got this fund set up with us. And rather than just being able to make grants, which you could do out of our fund, but you can do that out of your fund here, you get to participate in this thing we're calling venture philanthropy, which regardless of where the opportunity comes to you from, whether it's your own idea or an idea you see another donor has or an idea we may put in front of you, ultimately it's you recommending, if you're the fund holder, you're recommending to us to use your fund to make this loan, this investment, available grant. So that's how it gets started. Abundance then does its homework that's necessary to make sure it's compliant. It meets certain impact standards. A lot that we could say there, we can answer questions about later. Ultimately, we're making the investment. So we're making the loan to this business. We're making the loan to this fund on behalf of the donors. And as returns occur, repayments of loans, or maybe this is an equity position, the company sells and money comes out of that, we put the returns back into the angel funds. We distribute it back in the angel funds proportionate to how the participation occurred. How cool is it that we might be able to have philanthropy be a renewable resource? To figure out ways to do good with it that matter to you and see if we can recover some, all, or maybe even make a little money on that so you can do good again. So renewable philanthropy and philanthropy focused on economic development. So the last point, just to kind of close the loop, because I got this question last time. So you see how the 1-2-3 works. Well, returns come back in your fund. You can reinvest with that fund, or you could say, hey, grant that money back over into my fund over at the county foundation. Charlie, I think it's Charlie and Jack are going to go first and talk about a project that we're teaming up with them on. Well,
thank you guys. Quite a few guys in the room know about Upstate Warrior Solution. We've actually been here in Spartanburg for about 7 years now. We've moved all over town, but our new home for the last year has been right upstairs here in the Center for Philanthropy. So a big thanks to Troy and his team for inviting us in a year ago. Told Troy and team that we veterans would try to behave ourselves in this building. I think we have. We're still here. So it's been really great to be a part of this. A few folks on our team, Jack Sterling. Jack is running our program here, our entrepreneurship program. Greenville native, Navy SEAL veteran, is running his own small business on the side and works with us part-time, really doing probably just as much work as some of our full-time employees, Elizabeth Schottke, our development director, excluded. But Elizabeth's part of our team, and we've also Echo is Jack's service dog and is a part of the crew as well. So we wanted to give you guys a little bit about the pipeline of how we're finding these entrepreneurial vets. We've got folks in the back of the room, Ryan and Pat, that are retired military that are from this area that may not have an idea yet, but it's probably coming because a lot of our folks get a little disgruntled in corporate America and they come back to us saying, hey, I've got a great idea, or this is something that I've done. I'm in my second round, like help us out. So these folks in the back just retired from the military in the last couple of years are here. Please network with them. I invited them here to meet people as well. So Ryan, thanks for you and Pat being here. Just about kind of the big picture, we are obviously serving veterans and their families. We're also serving first responders now. We've got a first responder advocacy program. So we worked with several law enforcement officers here in the Spartanburg area to help them with transition issues. We do have a new center in Greenville. That's been something we've been really excited about, a 40,000 square foot facility, the Rupert Hughes Veterans Center. And this is really here kind of a micro version of that. And you can see our mission there to connect, lead, and inspire our warriors and their families. Kind of a little bit about the pipeline. We've got a lot of our veterans, first responders that are just coming to us for normal job support. So probably, you know, 90% of our population are trying to get a better job, a new job in corporate America. But we've got a small percentage of folks that are kind of spinning off of that group saying, I had an idea with my brother-in-law at the fire pit last weekend. Okay, got it. Like, we're going to work with those folks. But we've got also folks that are coming to us with well-developed business plans. They're well on the journey. And then we've got some folks that are moving here, especially during COVID, that are thriving businesses, and they just need more of a network, mentorship, potentially some funding. But we just want to help them grow their business because they're here now. So we're providing kind of services across that continuum. Jack's been with us for the past almost 2 years now doing this with just that small set-aside group of veteran entrepreneurs. So we're really excited about this program. So, you know, that's kind of the big pipeline, but this is really a rather nuanced piece to get to provide those folks services. We've tried not to step on the toes of existing organizations like SCORE, SBDC, other government organizations that do this. In addition to some of the incubators and accelerators that are here in the upstate, we want to partner with them and not try to duplicate that. But we do feel like this is hitting a gap area. I want to hand the mic over to Jack so he can talk about more of the nuts and bolts of how we're finding folks and what we're doing with them. So, Jack.
Thanks, Charlie. Howdy, everybody. We've only got about 35 slides, so it's going to be pretty quick. So, just kidding. Why launch a venture fund for something like Upstate Warrior Solutions? So after a year and a half, almost 2 years of interviewing veterans, we're pushing 140 today. The number one thing that folks are struggling with is funding. So believe it or not, in the military, there really isn't a function for funding. You know, as a CEO, I never had to go ask for funding to do anything we are doing. If you do, it's in a very different and kind of alien way from what we're looking at here for small businesses and startups. And so a lot of it starts with education. So a lot of folks come saying, hey, I'd like a grant for my business. And it's like, cool, what does your business do? Ammo. We sell ammo around the world. Like, there's no grants for that, right? So just educating folks on what a grant versus a loan is, when and where they should pursue something like that, how to prepare, all that stuff is kind of like the first pillar in what we're trying to do here. And the asks range widely, right? So most of the asks we're getting are in that $5,000, $10,000, $15,000 range. And that might be something like a small landscaping business that only has one truck and a trailer and a lawnmower and maybe some weed eaters. And the guy's like, I need to expand, but I need capital to expand so I can have a second crew or a backup truck in case this one breaks. And so no bank's going to touch that. That's too small potatoes for the big banks. And so this is really, like I think Mike said, this is really kind of a friends and family gap filling solution to say, hey, you know, you're a smart, driven, you know, you've proven yourself that you can run a business, but the funding is just you're struggling with that piece. And so whether it's education or actually seeding them with money, that's what we're looking to do. Our goals, we want to raise $500,000 this year and then fund five of our clients before the close of the year. So that could be anything from a, hey, we, you know, just a little bit of money to get you going to growth capital to anything in between. And I really like the friends and family round for those that don't have friends and family with means. That is where we're trying to occupy. If you got friends and family with means, you know, start there. But if you exhausted all your other opportunities for funding, then we're gonna be that friends and family. A couple of our more promising applicants that we've interviewed in the last year and a half. So Lazy Bear Winery, it's a husband and wife that were both 20-year Air Force veterans. They fell in love with the craft wine scene in Germany in their last post. And when they got out, they moved to Easley, South Carolina in retirement and started making wine for fun in their garage. And it was delicious. Their friends and family loved it. And they started selling it to strangers. And now they have a business called Lazy Bear Winery. And They sold over, they profited over $100,000 in their last year of business, which is pretty impressive considering no debt, no equity given up. It's all just organic growth for a business they really didn't even intend to start. They are nowhere near meeting the demand for what they sell. They sell a sweet berry wine that's high demand in the coast of the Carolinas and Georgia. And so they have people asking them for 10 times more than they've made in a year in 1 month. And so their demand is through the roof, and they just don't have the capital right now to build out operations to meet that demand. So we think they're a great candidate to invest in for this fund. Second one is vertical growth farming. So we've got a guy, like Charlie mentioned, moved to the upstate, I believe it was right before COVID, from California. He's a sixth startup as a startup founder. And he is, so he knows what he's doing. He needs, you know, friends and network in the area. And so we've helped him connect with network. He's got letters of intent to purchase his farm in a box from all over the world, food deserts, anywhere where there's, you know, a lack of, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables and produce. So it could be a city in Mexico, could be somewhere, overseas, could be, you know, a food desert in the United States, but he's got people that are interested, and he just needs money to make the first couple units to actually put on site and show people how it actually works. And so he's actually seeking to give up equity versus take it on a loan, take it on debt. So slide. So last slide here to give you guys an idea of the funding journey that we've seen so far and how we imagine this fund working. So I'm screening everybody we talk to, right? All of our clients, we sit down and do a one-on-one interview just off the top and figure out where they are in their journey. They could be, I've got an idea, need to help make it a reality. They could be, I've already started, need help growing. Could be, we're well grown, we need to open a second location, anywhere in those ranges. But not everyone's looking for funding. So the ones that are looking for funding, we help them prepare their business plan. If they've got one, we help polish it up. If they don't, we help start one from scratch. I say we, more likely our partners that are at Score or SBDC will help them prepare for funding. And then the ones that are actually qualified, they've already exhausted their other funding opportunities. They couldn't get funded elsewhere. We're going to submit those to our board quarterly. The board will take a look, ask questions, and then make decisions on who's going to get funded that quarter. So just how that's going to flow. And we imagine that of the 140 we talked to, maybe one or two or three are actually qualified candidates for funding today. So it's very much it's a numbers game. We'll get more through the door through referral, but we definitely believe that at least some of these candidates are very viable funding opportunities. So that's all I've got. Hand this back to Charlie.
Yeah, so before I pass it over to our friends at Aiden Bonding, we're really looking for two things. One, we're looking for just more folks in Spartanburg to get involved with this. We're gonna need a few folks on our selection committee to be from Spartanburg. We don't want this to be a Greenville-dominated thing. That's also why our nonprofit is here. So that's important to me. And then obviously we're going to be looking for investors into this fund. So that's something, as we wrap up, Mike and team, we're going to be talking about the vehicle for that. And then I would say thirdly, folks in your network that need these funds, we really need to get more deep here into the Spartanburg community to meet these folks. We know they're here, so please introduce them to us. So over to Simon or back to Mike?
I'm going to pass it to them in just a moment. I want to clarify one thing, since you all are a little different than how they'll describe, you know, working with us. So you might have caught on. What's happening here is that Upstate Warrior, in terms of how we fit in, Upstate Warrior, they have a fund with us. They're calling it their venture fund. They're putting multiple donors into that fund. And the way donors go into it, if a donor is an angel of ours and has a fund with abundance, then they can tell us they want to put funding into that pooled fund. And as that pooled fund, based on the process they're still working on and putting together here, as that pooled fund makes decisions to invest in various businesses or projects.
All right. My name is Simon Tui. Thank you guys. And Troy, thanks for having us here. Aiden Bonded is a project in the Northside area, and I'm going to quickly pass it over to Michael Williamson, who's president of the Northside Development Company. I'm a partner with Urban Realty Partners, a development group, and we'll be behind the development of this project. But we'll get into the weeds of what the project is, but we wouldn't be here today without what the Northside Development Group does and what they have been doing very successfully. A lot of work to be done, including one of these projects, but why don't we start with Michael, and he can kind of give you guys the big picture of what the Northside area is, which I'm sure many of you guys are very familiar with.
Thank you, Simon, and good afternoon, everyone. Again, my name is Michael Williamson, I'm CEO of Northside Development Group. I'm also joined today with my colleague, Tony Thomas, who is our community engagement manager and Northside Voyager and many other hats in the community. I'm sure you all know Tony. But wanted to talk a little bit about the Northside and what we do. I know a lot of familiar faces in the room. Our work is probably familiar to a lot of you. But those that aren't familiar, we are a comprehensive community development organization located in the Northside neighborhood of Spartanburg. Our 501c3 nonprofit organization was founded in 2011. And since then, we've been working to implement the vision of transformation in the Northside neighborhood. This is our transformation plan. We follow, and we are part of the Purpose-Built Communities Network. We follow their model. And so that includes cradle to career education pipeline, mixed income housing, economic vitality, and community health and wellness. So those are really the four pillars that we focus on. And that's all in an effort to increase racial equity, to improve health outcomes, and to increase economic mobility. Since we started, catalyzed nearly 500 multifamily units, mixed income, constructed over 40 homes for home ownership. We've assisted 18 families in the north side to purchase a home with down payment assistance, catalyzed 39,000 square feet of commercial and retail space, constructed the Franklin School, which is an early childhood learning center, ages 6 weeks to 4K, in partnership with a number of entities in the community. Worked with the city of Spartanburg to open the Dr. T.K. Gregg Center. So there's a lot of bright spots in the north side. But one of the not so bright spots in the north side is what we're here to talk about today. So in 2019, we partnered with the city of Spartanburg to acquire the Aiden Bonded Warehouses out of tax foreclosure, tax sale. And it's in that area that Simon's pointing at now. And we set to work, finding a development partner to help us redevelop this. And that's how we came in contact with Simon Tuohy and Rob Howell, who had done a similar project in Greenville called Hampton Station. So we worked with Simon and Rob and really sat down with the community and worked out what the desires of the community were, how we could redevelop this in a manner that's consistent with everything else that we've done in the north side. And so that's where I'll turn it over to Simon, and Simon can talk a little bit more about the details of the actual development.
Thank you, Michael. So Aiden Bonded is an existing structure that is partially standing. A lot of it has fallen down, as many of our partners here that I'll introduce you to are very aware of. Obviously, what we've got rendered here is the final product, but formerly it was a cotton storage warehouse along the train line there. But what we plan on turning it into is 111,000 square feet of adaptive reuse historic cotton warehouse. It'll be a $39 million project. We focusing on retail, education, arts, and entrepreneurial office space. We think in the process of it, we'll create 500 quality jobs, both full-time and part-time when the construction is happening. But the biggest thing that kind of really kicked off the project when Michael introduced the project, as well as Bill Barnett, we met Tony Thomas here, who's the head of the Voyagers, who's providing voice of the entire community of what they'd like to see here and what they'd like to get, was landing the tenants that this type of project needs. And unfortunately, Dana Hudgens was here earlier. She had to leave. But she's with the Upstate Workforce Board, South Carolina Works. We signed an LOI to go to lease about 2 years ago. This process has taken a long time, and rightfully so. And that kind of really kicked us off to say, okay, this we can make this work. As you'll see, the funding required for this requires, you know, to check a lot of boxes, and again, rightfully so. But that was the first one that really got us over the edge. And we've signed a lease where it's basically a below market rate rent for the project. So it allows her to be able to afford to be in the project, but it requires us to go out and get additional financing much more above and beyond a normal development deal. And a fantastic land with and Dr. Gail, and I apologize, Gail Awan is here with the Urban League of Upstate, and we are incredibly excited about that lease and LOI. Well, it was LOI, we're going to lease, and I'll let, because she could talk for a long time about what they're planning to put in there, but it's incredibly exciting. And then as we've also signed an LOI with Hub Kitchen, which is a minority-owned entrepreneurial. It's basically like a ghost kitchen. So if you have a food truck and you need a home base, this is it. If you've been, you know, my wife or my mother was a chef. She started out of her house, and you start out of the house and you need an actual fully functioning kitchen, that would be somewhere that you go in there. And so now that we've got these three main tenants, we want to focus on taking the project and making it real. Here is the capital stack, and this is where kind of why we are here working with Abundance Capital to kind of fill some of the gap that we have within the project. Like I mentioned, it is a very complicated financial structure, but we'll be getting a construction loan of $13.6 million. We have historic tax credits. Also, the state of South Carolina has the textile mill credit, which is very helpful. Will represent $12.5 million. We're then going out to the New Market Tax Credit community, and they will provide $7.4 million. Urban Realty Partners and NDG will be providing equity of $2.75. And here we are looking for impact equity, where it will be slightly different from you guys. We would be offering it as an equity piece with a 1% return, preferred return, and fully intending as the process goes, these two pieces are forgiven, and then the impact equity returns would happen. All of these requirements require us, New Market Tax Credits require us to be here for 7 years. It's also in an opportunity zone, and we fully intend to be a part of this project for a minimum of 10 years. And I know NDG is in for the long term 100%. This speaks to everything that this project Aiden Bonded is all about. NDG has done a tremendous job making changes and creating and revitalizing the Northside area. And Aiden Bonded will be a big, big project in the area. And we can't be more excited to get to work on it. But obviously need to fill some gaps, and that's what we're here for.
An add-on comment here, and then we'll open it up for questions. But when a developer is working with a great organization like Northside and trying to make a project like this work, traditional financing won't always get you there. And that's the conversations we've been having. When you have a high impact project like this, I've got a friend in Greenville who some of you all may know, he's an affordable housing developer. He says, don't build with cheap materials, build with cheap capital. And so this is a form of, we often call it concessionary capital, the ability to come into a capital stack like that, make it possible. Our donors want to see it work. They want to see this thing happen. So they're like, where can we fill in to have an impact and make sure a project like this works? So that's the gap that these guys have illustrated. So two totally different types of projects here, a nonprofit and a for-profit, but obviously all with impact orientation and impact intent, which is why we can work with them. Why don't we open it up for questions about the projects, about our inclusion in the projects, how you can get involved.
Hi, thank you. My name is Evelyn Blakely. I'm with Southside Sankofa, and we are trying to do some of the things that are being done on the north side, on the south side of Spartanburg. But I'd like to first start with the Upstate Warrior Solution. And I noticed that you're looking more at entrepreneurial and assistance to these various veterans. Are you also reaching out with the organizations that help homeless veterans, because there is a huge need for that, and specifically starting with Vietnam veterans, which are harder to reach because of the situation of when they came back to the United States from Vietnam. And then secondly, I did not hear you say anything about working with Power Up and One Spartanburg. You worked with SCDC and SCORE, but that seems to be something that is major in the area right now in funding. And what about non-traditional funding sources like the federal credit unions, because they look at things a lot differently than a normal bank would do?
So yeah, I can hit all three of those, ma'am, and thank you for that. So first off, on the homeless veteran piece, we're actually
counting homeless veterans right now. It's the point in time counting statewide. So United Housing Connections is our continuum of care lead, and they run that. So our team is a part of the CUSP chapter, the Cherokee Union Spartanburg.
So we're very in the weeds with that. We actually have a by name list of every homeless veteran in the 13 counties of the upstate that we are a part of a shared case management platform. We're working very closely with Beth and team Spartanburg. Is really the city's running point as kind of a subgroup of United Housing Connections. So we're definitely tracking homeless veterans. And sometimes there's folks that, especially a younger homeless veteran, that might kind of come out of that into this pipeline. So that's been done before. I think your second question was around partnering with like the Chamber, One Spartanburg. So absolutely, that's something that we have talked with Alan and team, getting veterans into college and into jobs, an opportunity to talk about the entrepreneurial piece. And we're actually members of SCASID. We've been learning about self-help credit unions very closely with Community Works.
Other questions?
For Simon, my name's Andy Falatalk. I understand the need to want to revitalize, say, the Aiden warehouses in the north side. Have you done a study to see if there's a demand? Because there's maybe 14 million square feet of warehousing being constructed in Spartanburg County with not a lot of people coming to the table. I didn't know if you looked at, is there a demand for this 111,000 square feet in that area? If you did a market study.
Yeah, no, that's a very good question. But we have done a market study, and the demand is there. We are spreading and kind of diversifying the project itself between, you know, we're 40% pre-leased with the leases or LOIs that we have right now. And the reason they're not leases yet is because we're just not there to go with the project. So we're 40% occupied. We feel like we've got about 20,000 square feet of restaurant spaces. So we're going to make it an entertainment facility as well, but mainly focused on education. We've also got, we're working with the city of Spartanburg to do some programming for arts programs, and you know, doggy daycare. If I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with Hampton Station in Greenville, but we are kind of copying a lot of the actual tenants that are within there. And we do feel like the draw from Spartanburg will not only be from the north side area, but Spartanburg in general, for potential, you know, clients, for the tenants that are there. We most definitely have done a market study.
Jack Klein, I have a question for Jack. I was looking at the slide of the two companies that you had helped. Could you elaborate maybe on a few more of the other companies of some of the successes you've had since you started?
We ask anybody coming to those meetings to bring a problem, something they're actively working on, and then we try and crowdsource ideas and solutions for it. And so we've had some nice successes out of that, people increasing sales, increasing revenue, just from sharing with other veterans and realizing they're not alone. That's one of the biggest missing pieces when you leave military or firefighter or law enforcement community. You don't have that team anymore. You're on your own. Your business growth just from sharing and collaborating with other veterans doing the same thing or similar, you know, running their own business, whatever the business may be. So I'll give you an example. We have a Navy, I believe she's a captain, and she runs a travel agency, helps people book travel internationally, mostly cruises these days. But, and she's like, I just need more volume, right? I'm doing a lot of sales operations, not getting a lot of sales. And so we said, well, do you ever ask for referrals from your existing clients? And she said, not really. Maybe when they get back, I'll ask them. But so someone else in the group, wasn't me, recommended that she send them a mid-trip email. Said, hey, just checking in. Want to make sure everything with your trip is going great. If everything's great, you can just ignore this email. But also, if you book your next cruise while you're still on this cruise, we'll give you a 10% discount. And that she had like 10 new sales just doing that from her existing clients while they're on their cruise. And so that's a small example, but is one that comes to mind thinking about success we've had outside of funding. Because to be honest, we have not had a lot of people successfully get funded so far. It's kind of why we're here.
Okay, one question regarding the bonded warehouse. How diverse will your offerings be? Everything that I see is for the under 40 crowd. And when you look at South Carolina, it's becoming more gray every day because you have people like me who is a tweener. I'm from New York. You have people moving up from Florida because of the weather. They're older. So where are the supper clubs, the jazz clubs, the things of that nature that people of our age can go to because we're not worried about the low slung pants and the other things that go with the younger people?
Okay, you got me. Very good question. And as far as the entertainment pieces of Aid and Bonded, we feel like right now we're talking to some folks, but we're waiting for the project to really get started so that you can actually, it's a tough tour right now. Dr. Awan, I appreciate you being able to see the vision because the roofs are completely falling in and it's a rough looking site right now. So the vision is tough for the retailers. But once we feel confident, once we start breaking ground, that's where we will be going after our kind of entertainment, retail focused tenants like that. So we don't have specific things landed there, but I hear you, and we'll make a mental note here to make sure that we're taking care of that. At Hampton Station, we do have a variety. You know, we have one tenant, and we're going to have these entrepreneurial spaces, but we have one tenant who's in about maybe 500 square feet. It's called Bobby Pins, and they give classes to kids after school, and they're literally just coloring and doing fun stuff and making noises. But then we also have another group that's going to open up a jazz club. And we're really excited about that. And so it really covers all age demographics. And that is exactly what we want here. We want it to, you know, really focus on families where someone can come with their kids. And again, I'm talking on the entertainment side outside of all the education and the stuff that we're really driving hard on. But a 20% piece of this, which is the fun part to talk about sometimes. But, you know, you come with your family and you can be in an area where your kid can be playing, maybe not in your eyesight, but you can enjoy a meal, have a conversation with family. And so we're going to create good family-friendly, kid-friendly places to play around, as well as entertainment for the grayer community. I don't know if that's the correct way to say it, but I'm trying to cut. Yeah, seasoned. There we go. And I'm right there with you.
So I'm Gail Awan with the Urban League of the Upstate, and this project for me really represents a lot of the populations that we're talking about as far as entrepreneurs, developing a work base, tourism, economic development. So about 2 years ago, the Urban League, a partner with the South Carolina Film Commission, right? The Film Commission to asked us to help us advance kind of the awareness of the film industry of South Carolina and to help attract and retain, right, a diverse group of persons that can help perform those globalized careers. So for the past 2 years, the Urban League has offered classes, free classes for grips, for hairdressers and stylists, and for individuals interested in production finance. So this is not to replace anything that you're doing. For example, we had a returning vet that was in his construction business, but he also wanted to do something creative. So he took our grip class, right, and immediately started working on Outer Banks. So what we're doing here, I think it's those back spaces there, is we will have an independent film theater, as well as a technology-based virtual studio. This is about computers. So the Urban League, in true sort of Spartanburg fashion, we commissioned research to really understand the current and future jobs of the South Carolina film industry. Like, what are those jobs that we're going to need? And so we started doing those classes and offering those classes. And what's happening is our research is being used actually this week on a panel discussion for the Greenville Business Magazine about the role of the South Carolina film industry on the state's labor workforce. In addition to that, next week, we're meeting with the South Carolina Public Charter School System about incorporating this training into their workforce centers for excellence. So I was talking just Monday, actually, director who actually lives in New York, but for the past 5 years, they've been shooting in Charlotte, who works for the Oprah Winfrey Network, all of her Christmas series, as well as other television series for Lionsgate Entertainment. And what explained to the importance of this 84 corridor for directors and producers that work between Charlotte and Atlanta. And he said to me, so Gail, I really get it. If this Amy Bonded warehouse in Spartanburg becomes the hub for workforce, a film crew workforce, camera operators, grips, production assistants, it becomes more economical and practical for us to do business there. He also said, look, I'm from York, South Carolina. My entire family still lives in York County. So I remember, he said, I remember, it's like a light bulb. I remember what happened when Carolyn's came to town. He said, this Amy Bonded warehouse has the opportunity to connect the Carolina film industry in the same way. So that's why we're really excited about this.
I didn't do Dana Hudgens a good job when I'm put on the spot. I get a little nervous and just blow it off in my future. But the South Carolina Works, which was the first deal we're signing, is in this bay here. I don't know if you guys are all familiar with them, but placing folks in jobs and training them in order to get into jobs. So that is a huge piece of what we're working for, and Aiden Bond will be here.
When you all, I think you said this, but you're raising money now, and when do you plan to actually launch it? So people need to get their steps in play, reach out, and talk to their network.
We really need to get our review committee together, so we're trying to get a good cross-section of folks from the upstate that have experience doing this, but also just folks in the business community that are maybe semi-retired and just have the energy to be a part of the review committee. So that's really the first piece. And then as the funds are flowing in, Jack's already got, probably four or five folks that are chomping at the bit to pitch to this review committee. So the pipeline is not necessarily the issue. We just need to take really the spring as we're raising the funds to get the program up and running. So anything to add to that?
Yeah, just one thing to add is that, on the education piece, once we start telling people this is an option for them for funding, that I think we'll have more people coming and say raising their hand. We are already getting number one ask is funding. And so we help them kind of educate on what's out there as far as options, how to connect with them, how to prepare to, ask for funding. But a lot of folks they're starting from total scratch. And so, once we start educating people and including this option, I think people are going to start to be a little more imaginative about how they can seek funding.
Y'all have already brought partners together in there.
Correct. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
To help all the way up the scale. Sounds good.
Yeah, and to that, SCORE is actually located here in this building. They're a key partner of ours. So SCORE has a satellite office here co-located with us upstairs. So that's another great way to get involved. If you'd like to be a SCORE mentor, that's an SBA program to do business coaching. So that's a way you could be directly involved with this program as well.
All right. Well, thank you so much for being here, for attending. It's been inspiring hearing all these innovative ideas. My mind was just turning when hearing Dr. Gale of all the educational opportunities involved with that. Thank you all for coming. If you have any questions about the process that Mike was talking about, you can contact Mike at Abundance Capital. If it's regarding your fund here at the foundation, you can contact me. And I hope you have a great rest of your day. Thank you for coming.